नमस्ते, वेलकम टू दिस सेशन ऑन व्हाट लाइज अहेड पोस्ट कोविड-19 फॉर अफोर्डेबल प्राइवेट स्कूल्स। माय नेम इज अमित एंड आई एम गोइंग टू मॉडरेट दिस सेशन। आई वर्क एज अ सीनियर कंसल्टेंट विद सेंट्रल स्क्वायर फाउंडेशन एंड टुडे आई हैव अ वंडरफुल पीपल टू हैव डिस्कशन ऑन दिस सब्जेक्ट। To introduce the topic, at times we may not realize that India today has the largest private school system. We may not realize with our focus, but in the world, India hosts the largest number of students in private schools. And within this segment, the number of private schools we have currently in India has roughly 15 lakh schools, out of which 11 lakhs are government-run schools and roughly 4 lakhs are private schools. These private schools together roughly accommodate 50% of country's enrollment, which will come roughly 12.5 crore students. And these 12.5 crore students in private schools, no other country in the world has. But in our education policy, our discussion, our debates, our effort, our missions to improve quality education, et cetera, sometime we feel that this segment gets ignored, does not get as much of priority as possibly desired. And within the very interesting thing is that our own study, Central Square Foundation came up with a study called State of the Segment Report, which talks about that roughly 90% private schools in the country charge a fee which is below 2,000 rupees a month. Pause for a second and think about it. 90% private schools in the country charge a fee which is below 2,000 rupees a month. And this segment is what we call or refer broadly as affordable private schools. Now, we know that the world is facing one of the biggest pandemics of the recent time, the biggest challenge. And to mitigate the impact of pandemic, while almost everything was closed down, March 2020, India went into a lockdown mode and almost everything, all economic activities were halted. Schools were also closed down. But soon we realized that life has to continue and we started unlocking process. And slowly we have unlocked almost everything but schools. Schools were opened last year briefly during examination time before the second wave of COVID. No one knew about the second wave of COVID. But as the second wave came, once again, all the schools were closed down, and now there is a prediction for third wave. So altogether, for roughly more than 500 days, schools in India have been closed. And this is the situation that the entire education system is facing, but there is a unique proposition here. What is that? While others were basically thinking about while school buildings are non-operational, what do we do to mitigate learning losses? But so they were only thinking from their demand side of it that we have our students. What do we do so that there is some of the learning teaching activities continuing? But in case of private schools and specifically affordable private schools, they not only had demand side of tension, they also had supply side of tension because they also had to think about financial viability, the sustainability, whether schools can sustain in this changed circumstances or not. So this is what I briefly wanted to talk to give you a context for this panel when we are going to talk about what lies ahead for APS post COVID-19. This is what we want to broadly discuss. What is happening in this change situation? And to discuss this, I have panel of these four wonderful speakers who, whenever I talk, we have endless conversation, because almost every time I get amazed with the nuance and the detailed observations they have. Let me introduce the first speaker for the day, Mr. Vikas Jhunjhunwala, who is founder of Sunshine School in Delhi. He runs two schools, interestingly. One is in Delhi and another one is in Ghaziabad. Then we also have Mr. Vardhan Kabra, who is co-founder of Fountainhead School, Surat, and is also an educationist and a blogger involved in multiple things. Recently, he has also come up with a very interesting report. I think Vardhan would be mentioning sometime during the course of our conversation. And then to represent school, private school association perspective, we have Mr. Rajendra Singh, who is the working president of Independent English Schools Association in Maharashtra. And we also have Professor Geeta Gandhi Kingdon, who is chair of education and international development at University College London. And she will be bringing a research perspective, data perspective, policy perspective in this conversation. So with these four wonderful people, let me begin the session. And to begin the session, as I started talking about the economics of private schools, the sustainability model. So pre-pandemic, pre-COVID-19, the sustainability model was whatever it was. What I wish to understand first, and I would like to direct this question to Professor Kingdon, how the economics of affordable private schools has changed, how the enrollment number has gone down, the teacher salaries have been negotiated, or there were directions from the government to reduce fee, etc., etc. So what is happening in terms of the economics of affordable private schools? Geetaji, you may unmute yourself.
Yeah, thank you, Amit. The data on these things, unfortunately, is not precise. It's not extensive. Even the recent Central Square Foundation report on the impact of COVID on, private schools, on the budget private schools, it acknowledges that, it had to take as its sample, there is no sampling frame of schools from which it could draw a sample, and therefore it took those that were available in the digital space, the list of the names of schools that were available there, and from there it sampled, and therefore it cautions that this may be missing out the truly budget private schools. This may be from a higher end of the budget private schools that they've got data. So I think that with that caveat, it is clear that in most of the states, the fee was not allowed to be increased, for one thing, despite the existence of, fee regulation acts that permit an annual increase of fees. Because the timing of the closure of the schools was, around March time, mid-March, and, from April, May and June, parents just did not pay fee for those 3 months. So it became extremely difficult for schools to pay the salaries of those 3 months. When schools did reopen for online education, roughly from early July, most of the parents could not afford the fee. They could not pay the fee in these affordable private schools, because remember, who are the people who are attending these schools? I have some data here from NSS, the National Sample Survey data. And what it shows is that Amit, you referred to it briefly about, the state of the sector report on private schooling last year by the Central Square Foundation. You cited a figure from that. I can give a slightly more detailed figure. So median is a better measure of central tendency when you have a quantity like income or fee levels, which are highly lognormally distributed, like, fee level is. So median school fee of all children who say that they are studying in private school and who are aged 6 to 14 years old, The median fee in rural India in the year 2017-18, which is the latest year for which we have national sample survey data available with this information, the median fee in rural India was 590 rupees per month. And in urban India, it was 944 rupees per month. And if you take the weighted average of these, for India as a whole, the single number is 788 rupees per month. Was the central tendency of the fee level in India in 2017-18 for children of the elementary school going age who are attending private and aided schools. So we can see that the vast majority of the children who study in private and aided schools in our country are from poorer homes, because the fee that they are, the kinds of schools they're choosing to send their children to, are charging roughly on an average 790 rupees per month, less than 800 rupees per month. Of course, that figure is, if you look at it in relation to rural incomes, that figure is still, would be regarded by quite a good proportion of the families as a high figure. So that's why not all children who might want to avail of it have been able to avail of it. So I think that, yes, parental ability to pay fees did drop very significantly over the COVID period. And those who send their children to private schools are mostly in low-paid occupations, which were particularly badly affected by the COVID period. So I think, another perspective, which is based on data that I could share, which I think is of interest here, is, access to some kind of an online education over this period necessarily was dependent on availability not only of a device at home, an appropriate device, but also internet access. Now, again, we have only national sample survey data 2017-18. So that's the latest that's available. And of course, it is the case that over this period, there would have been a massive increase in the availability of, internet access at home. Having said that, if you look at the reports that are out by the Central Square Foundation, by USAR last year in September, you find that internet access penetration, although it has increased, is still at a very much lower level, at only about one third of the population, or 35% or so, having internet access in rural areas. So I just wanted to share with you how it differs by two parameters. One is by private and public school, and one is by income level of the family. Let's look at the income level of the family. If I divide all the population of the country into four income quartiles, okay, four equal groups, by their monthly per capita expenditure of the family, what I find is that in the high income group, the highest income quartile, the top 25% of the most well-off people in the country, internet access at home was 59% among that group. And if I had to look at the bottom income quartile, the internet access was only 13% of the families in the bottom quartile had access to internet in their home. And if you look at ability to use internet, 81% of high-income families children aged 15 to 19 in the high-income families, 81% of them had ability to use internet. And in the low-income families, 23% declared in the age 15 to 19 that they had ability. So I think that it has been a period, and I think what the implication of this is, that like any other school, there will have to be a massive recovery. It signifies, these numbers signify that despite the best efforts of the budget private schools, it will necessarily be the case that many children nevertheless have got left out of education, so that when, in the post-COVID time, there will need to be a massive recovery effort in budget private schools as well. Of course, more for those who were not able to do any form of online education, which would probably be the lowest fee budget private schools, but even for the others who were able to do some kind of online education, I think there will have to be a massive recovery. Later on in the program, what I would really like to say, because the topic of the day is what lies ahead for the affordable private schools post-COVID. And, I think there's so much to be said about that, particularly because we now have the national education policy that came partway through the COVID period, and it has some promises for private schools. Some really interesting change of direction seems to have been suggested, but it is full of ambiguities as well, so that the problems that is going to spawn, I think those really deserve our attention.
Thank you very much, Geetaji, and thank you very much for keeping your all the input to the point. So as I see, there are two phase challenges. Number one, that the parents' income itself dropped significantly, and therefore their capacity to pay fee was reduced. And the second part is also the schools, because of non-availability of devices or not having access to internet, schools also could not do much. And therefore, that I think paralyzed the entire segment. But this indicates me that in this case, if schools were not able to run any kind of learning teaching activities, there would be massive, massive learning loss. Let me take Vikas' opinion here, because Vikas is a practitioner. He runs an affordable private school. Vikas, what has been your observation? Do you find something similar happening, something different happening? What is your ground level experience?
Thanks, Amit. thanks for inviting me. As you had rightly said, I run two schools in the Delhi NCR area. So I can provide a perspective in terms of what's happened in my schools and sort of a urban perspective. And actually, the data is very consistent with what, the experience is very consistent with the data that Geeta shared. But actually, before getting into that, I just wanted to highlight sort of The Economist had an article in their January 9th edition. And the title of the article was about the crisis in the sector. And it was titled, Private Schools That Educate 50% of Indian Children Are Folding, right? And they were specifically talking about budget private schools or affordable private schools. And I think that's, and I'm glad that you mentioned basically, I think it's only recently, and you and I were talking about how probably about 5 years ago, and in fact, many forums, Central Square Foundation is still basically positive towards us. But in many forums, there's not even a space for, there wouldn't even be a session about the private school segment, you know, because basically all the conversation, certainly about the affordable private school segment. So all the conversation is consistently about government system, government system, government system. And there's nothing wrong with that. But if you think about basically any, and I think just taking the numbers that you had said and just taking it one level down to just pure basic market share by enrollment. So I think if as you said, 90% of the private unaided schools, as mentioned in the Central Square Foundation State of the Sector report, charge a fee of less than 2,000 rupees. Now, if you really look at the market share that represents or enrollment share, that's about 32%. 32%. That's basically one third of the education sector in terms of children, right? And that represents 8 crore or 80 million children, right? That's more than the size of most countries in the world, right? If you look at basically even a lower figure, which is less than 1,000 rupees, because you might say, well, 2,000 rupees for middle class ho gaya, right? So if you look at less than 1,000 rupees, you know, the numbers that basically came up were about 70%.
It's 80%. 80.2% of children who are studying in private unaided schools are paying less than 1,000 rupees per month.
Right. And so that number is about 25 to 30% of enrollment share. We're talking about 33%. One third of India's children are studying in private schools, in affordable private schools, right? So this is not a joke. This is not something that you can just kind of, arey yaar, ye to kuch schools hai aur kuch bachche hai. I was just comparing it with the banking sector. You know what the share is of the private banks in terms of loans? The share is 36%. So private banks in India have a market share of 36% as far as loans is concerned. And do you think that anyone would talk about the health of the banking sector in India and not really, and just ignore, you know, the private banks? I mean, that would be silly. That would be, you know, self-defeating to do that. But I think that generally the feeling that we get, and I'm going to be a little bit controversial over here, because I think it's important that we basically highlight just the craziness which we see sometimes, you know, in terms of how this whole private school segment, which is 50%, by the way, 50% is a huge understatement, because this basically A does not look at the thousands of unrecognized schools. All of this data is coming from the DICE report or the DICE data. The DICE data indicates zero schools are unrecognized. I mean, that's laughable. I mean, everyone knows that har ek gali mein, in fact, let's be honest, one of my schools is unrecognized because we haven't still been able to get the recognition because it's been stuck because of COVID, right? So, I mean, this is ridiculous to say that basically, you know, unrecognized schools hai nahi. Also, we also know, in fact, there was a session recently, earlier, which talked about the double counting of children in government schools. And in Andhra, they basically did some work in terms of reducing double counting through Aadhaar seeding. And they suddenly saved crores of rupees in terms of midday meals because there were so many children. So I think even the 50% is an underreporting, right? And so I guess what I'm trying to say is that the feeling that we get, and I'm talking about a practitioner perspective, and it's a, and I do, you know, I speak for myself, but I think generally I speak for a lot of other people who are my colleagues, is that we really are the outcast, or I would say even the word Dalit, of the caste, of the education caste system in India, right? I mean, the government schools have the power of the government behind them, right? And the private and the elite private schools, although I really don't think that they have, you know, they have that much of say, but certainly they have more resources, you know, than we do. We are really at the bottom of the totem pole. We are basically providing an education to 80 million children without a single rupee being spent by the taxpayer. You know, at a price point that Geeta can tell you, he has all the data in terms of at a price point, which is ridiculously low compared to what the government pays, government sort of spends, right? Yet we feel unwanted, you know, by everyone. You know, if you look at the policymaker, if you look at the bureaucrat, if you look at prominent educationalists and prominent NGOs and the media, I mean, the words that are used for us, you know, I mean, Amit and, you know, we were talking about the fact that we're talked about like, ye to jalebi wale hai, these are teaching shops. You know, these are basically people, you know, schools that are mushrooming all over the place, commercialization of education. Like, it's almost like the feeling is that, why do you exist when the government schools are there for the poor? Like, what is your raison d'etre? Why are you even there? So I think what I want to say is that basically, let's talk about that. Why do we exist? Why do budget schools exist? I mean, they exist because it's a market-based solution to a problem that basically started post-liberalization, where the poor said that, given that India is basically, they started getting some money because the economy started doing better, and they saw that education was the way for the English education and a better education was the way for the children to get out of poverty, right, in their lifetime. And they basically decided, based on what they saw, that they would spend willingly 20 to 30% of their household income. I'm not joking. I mean, basically, you know, the average household has 2 to 3 children going to their going to the school. And, you know, and this is, I've been in this sector for about 6-7 years now. And I can tell you that we're talking about poor people who are at 10 to 15,000 rupees per month in Delhi NCR. So this is not middle class by any stretch, spending 20 to 30% of the income, sending the kids to my school or to other budget private schools, because they believe that this is an important sacrifice for them to make to provide a better education for their children compared to the free option. Right. They have, it's almost like saying that Jio is providing you with telephone services for free. And yet people are basically paying money hand over fist to Airtel. I mean, that just wouldn't happen unless there was a significant value difference. I mean, it's easy to say that garib log kuch idea nahi hai, dhoka de rahe hai. But would any person like choose Airtel if Jio was giving the service for free and it was a comparable service? That just doesn't make any sense. Right. So I think the reason why budget schools have been growing and have basically been increasing market share since post-liberalization is primarily because, you know, let's be honest, because government schools have not been able to deliver, and that has left the space open for a market-based solution, which is the budget private schools. Now, going back to your question, Amit, sorry, I've taken a little bit of time, but because it's a market-based solution, therefore, it's important for us to provide value to the customer. So it's sort of like, you know, if you had the Airtel option, if Airtel was a Jio option, Jio was giving it to you for free, Airtel would have to provide some significant value for customers to pay, right? So the challenge that has happened because of COVID is that we have not, so two challenges. I think I'm just going to mimic what Geeta said. One is that the informal and the blue collar sector has been devastated by the first wave, and the economist was talking about the first wave and now the second wave, and it's been absolutely devastating. I have people who come to me and say, pichle saal to humne manage kar liya hamari savings ke through, but ab to savings bhi khatam ho gayi hai. So these people are not coming back to us right now. Eventually, hopefully, it then depends on the state of the economy. If the economy improves and the informal and the blue collar workers are able to get better as far as their economic circumstances go, then they will come back to us. So we've lost that. The other is basically, I think, people who are basically waiting for offline classes to start. because our schools were not really designed, you know, we're not like a Byju's that basically was designed for online classes, right? And the students have problems in terms of device access, in terms of internet connectivity, etc. So we have people who are waiting at the margins for that. So the end result for us particularly is that we have 50% of our students who have come back. Our revenues are down by less than 50% because we've had to give fee waivers and discounts and things like that. But our expenses have really remained almost similar because the two major expenses are rent and teacher salaries. And that has not come down dramatically. So I think I'll end with basically saying what they said in the article, which is that it has been a disaster. So I don't think I can sugarcoat it by saying anything else. It's a really, really bad situation on the ground right now.
Thank you, Vikas. Very important, pertinent point. But at some point of time, I think we all need to also think about why there is such a discriminatory approach, why there is so much of caste system happening and outcasting of APS happens. Quickly now, because in the interest of saving time, and I really want to take the discussion to other speakers too. Let me move to Rajendra. And Rajendra ji, through you, I would like to know, how do you see the parents and parental engagement changing pre and post COVID? During the dead situation, call for a kind of tension between schools and parents, how things have happened, a relationship has become better, worse? What is that happening?
To the question you have asked, Aminji, parental engagement into this country, India, with such a number of population and large number of people in parental, it's very difficult or impossible to say as a parental engagement, because we diversify and we really don't know what's happening at home. But I would like to still answer the question. I don't want to say, I know about parental engagement here. But it's a very diversified country. I don't think anybody can specifically answer this question. But I'll try to finish it as soon as possible. See, pre-COVID, the student goes to school, the student comes back, the student goes to tuition, comes back, education is done. That was the story. Mostly, we are going to generalize. So, go to school, go to tuition, exam, padhai karo, end of the story. And of course, a lot of parents are aware, so they used to see how much the student has achieved and so forth and so on. When online education started, as rightly said by Vikasji, we were not prepared. No one was prepared. But online is not the complete answer to the education system we foresee, but it's definitely a support system to fill in the learning gap. Okay. So when online started, we trained our teachers and teachers went on screen. The first parent reaction was judgment. Judgment about language. Isko to English aati nahi hai. Ye to aise baat nahi karte hain. So the first answer was judgment, which we received in the first phase of the online education. And we told them that the content is more important for a maths teacher or a science teacher. And yes, we will improve, and we gave them assurances. So what I'm trying to, if you put it in one word, it was a lot of insecurity of how it's going to be. But thereon, when they saw, they really started gaining some confidence that, okay, private schools are doing a great job, mostly. My child is engaged, otherwise there would no education what he would be doing it at home. And then they started and understood it that now in this pandemic, education was not like early, school gaya, tuition gaya and over. It has to be hand in hand with the parent. The school and the parent, irrespective of the educational background they come from, has to work to see that the child's learning loss is reduced. So that was the second phase of the lockdown, how parent reacted to us. Moreover, when we see the next year, now the coming year, now all the parents are very, they want basically in their mind is they want the schools to be started because they have understood the most important thing the pandemic taught all of us, the importance of the school's atmosphere, the ecosystem of the school. And when they have understood that, ki, wow, it is not only math, science and English and those marks, it is the whole ecosystem the private school is providing. And my child is getting ready for life into that ecosystem, which is not happening now. That is what the realization has come to. And now parents and students, all of us have started realizing that we need to open the schools as soon as possible, maybe alternate days or following the SOPs given by the guidelines given by the municipal corporations or the state. About fees and other things, I will not further on discuss because a lot of us said is already been said by my friends Vikas Ji and Geeta ma'am. That is a situation I would say school to school, and the parents need to see once they understand that the school and me are not two different bodies I need to fight with, rather one ecosystem, then they will fulfill the responsibility of fees. That's what I feel. So it's more of an understanding of where we come from and where we stand rather than, you know, putting it in one box or one compartment. I hope I am satisfactorily answering your question, Amit. You have muted yourself.
Pretty much. Thank you very much, Rajendraji. And yes, very good learning. I think once the online education started and it opened, so this earlier in a classroom, what was happening that there is a teacher and students and whatever is being practiced, it remains in that classroom. Now this classroom was wide open in house and parents were also sitting with the kids and they could also see the level of engagement and the quality of teaching and et cetera, and that made them pretty much judgmental. But soon, I think we also realized the importance of physical infrastructure and the ecosystem that the school gives and that cannot be undermined. With the same question, let me move to Vardhan. And Vardhan, certainly I would like you also to briefly share your experience on the parents' engagement, but also slowly move to touch a little bit of the next important stakeholder, important segment in the school ecosystem, which is teachers. So I would also like to know that how do you see the this change situation, what kind of impact it had on teachers in terms of their scope of employability, increasing jobs or reducing jobs, new skills they were required to learn, or classroom management or teaching practices, et cetera, et cetera. How that has been impacted due to COVID-19. Vardhan, please.
Yeah, thanks, Amit. I think for teachers, it has been a really challenging period because as Rajendra said, I mean, schools were really not meant to be online. I mean, the way we've been operating. And for teachers to switch within days or weeks to a completely online method was very, very challenging. And the challenge was on multiple fronts. So, I mean, if schools which could manage to run live classes have device issues, where do the teachers get devices from? Where do they use their mobile phones, which are not at all suited for, you know, running a live class? Or do they get a laptop? If yes, where do they get it? Who's going to pay for it? Do they have a stable internet connection? Who's going to pay for that? You know, on top of that, most schools had to cut down on teacher salaries, either temporarily or even for the whole year. Because if the school fees has gone down by 50%, 60%, whatever the number is, it's a range, or 20%, even if it is 20%. But we know, as Vikasji said, that the biggest, I mean, two chunk for any school expenses, teacher salaries. And if expenses, income goes down, teacher salaries cannot remain the same. So not only are you doing a lot of, you are not only as a teacher, are you expected to do a lot of new things, but you're not even earning what you were earning the previous year. Forget an increment. I mean, forget getting an increment for it or getting, you know, being appreciated for the kind of work. And then on top of that, what Rajendra said, there is huge amount of scrutiny, every word out of place, every, you know, every instruction that doesn't go well. is scrutinized by parents. Of course, it depends on the kind of parents. The parents of who can afford to stay home are the ones who would scrutinize more. That may not be the case with affordable private schools, where in any case, devices are a big challenge for students at their homes. So I think for teachers to switch to a completely new method of teaching, working from home, managing, and for those lockdown periods, there wasn't help at home for so many teachers. It was doing everything for the family, including managing classes. So it was really, really challenging for teachers, and it still continues to be. Now that there is, it is sort of a new normal, I think people have adapted and have systems to help support them. But I don't think teachers are happy about the whole situation in general, and it has impacted tech skills. Everyone, technology, I think people have learned, I mean, because they've had no choice. And that is something that I think is sort of one silver lining in this whole cloud. But also how much use that can have in the classroom going forward is a question that has to be seen, because again, you have to have the technology inside the classroom to be able to use it effectively. So without that, it's not going to happen. But there is a possibility of a lot of schools may look at hybrid models going forward, that there are some things which can happen online, especially if it is in a mass, and then a lot of those interactions which are one-on-one or in smaller groups can happen in the classroom. So there are these areas that teachers have had to learn on. Classroom management, Rajendra has already spoken about some of the challenges. It's mostly the challenges of managing parents rather than managing students that much. So if teachers have managed to manage parents, then I think it's classroom management as such is easier, because, well, you can mute students, you can maybe kick them out. So it's actually some ways, I feel it's easier for teachers to manage online classes if it's their live classes. If they're anyway doing recorded classes, then there's nothing to manage in terms of classroom. You're just sending videos on WhatsApp or and then getting worksheets on, on WhatsApp or other means, and checking and marking them and all of those things. So in some ways, classroom management has become easier as far as students are concerned. But I'm also seeing in Gujarat, classes have opened up for grade 9 to 12 for about 3 weeks now. And teachers are like struggling to adapt back to a physical classroom setup, because they're used to sitting in one place, you know, just giving instructions, that sort of. So it's a little more challenging for them now. But I think that's something teachers will get back once they're in class for some time.
Great. Thank you very much, Vardhan. Also, let me mention that we have all the audience, those who are watching this discussion, they can post their question either in the chat box or the question answer segment. And I would request all our panelists also that there are some questions and pointers being posted there. In the meantime, they can also reply here. And few of these questions, if with the time permits, we will also take here in the panel discussion. So for our audience, please keep posting questions. And this is where I would quickly like to bring Geeta ji. In terms of parents' role and engagement, and you were talking about a study being done in Pakistan where they found that first generation learners had different level of learning. Why don't you briefly talk about it, keeping time in mind?
Sure, I will. So there is a research program called RISE, Research into Improving Systems of Education, which is based at the University of Oxford. And there's a lot of good research emanating from that research group. One of the papers that came out was the long-term impacts of a disaster on children's learning. And this paper, which is by Jishnu Das and other authors, Tahir Andrabi and so on. This paper looks at the impact of a quite a devastating earthquake that happened in northwest Pakistan in the year 2005. They take data from 2009 in the quake affected areas, and they compare that with a nearby area that was not quake affected. Schools, because of this earthquake, had been closed for 14 weeks. That's about 3.5 months. What they found is that 4 years after the quake, rebuilding had happened in the quake affected area. So they had new infrastructure, you know, school buildings had been built again or repaired, and, you know, roads had come up and good new infrastructure had come up. So if anything, infrastructure wise, the quake affected area was either the same as the adjoining non-affected area, or even better by now. Other outcomes for adults were good. Health outcomes were equal in both these areas. But the one thing that was different was children's learning level. Children's learning levels were 1.5 to 2 years behind the non-quake affected areas in these areas, in the quake affected area. And what they found is that only 10% of that deficit in learning, that, you know, the loss in learning was due to the fact that the schools were closed for 3.5 months. The 90% of the loss of learning was because that when the children came back to school after 3.5 months, teachers just took the curriculum from where they had left off and they just started to implement the curriculum from then on. What they did not realize is that there would be a massive loss of learning in a 3.5 month period. In just such a short period, there was a big loss of learning, and teachers did not understand that this would have happened, and they just continued the curriculum from where they'd left off, which meant that a lot of children who had had this depreciation in learning and loss in learning, could they just got left behind, and they never caught up. The other major finding here was that the children who were badly affected in this way were the children of mothers who were not educated. Children whose mothers were educated were totally protected from any loss in learning. They had just the same amount of learning as the children in the non-affected areas. So I think these are two major things that we can learn from for this study. Particularly, one of them is actionable. One of them is amenable to policy by the school, namely that when children come back, it is extremely important to test the children for where they are when we restart school, and then to have a recovery program. In countries like, for example, in the United Kingdom, they have a recovery program, which of course the teachers are saying that it is not enough. But at any rate, the government has put in place a recovery program whereby every single child will be entitled to, I think it is a certain number of hours of private tutoring, which will be paid for by the government based on their learning level. So this is called the recovery program. Amit, one thing I wanted to say, apart from what I've just said about the long-term effects of a disaster on learning, I wanted to just comment on what Vikas was saying, because I so agree with what he has said. Basically, what I feel is that there is a lack of a narrative. There's lack of a coherent narrative in India about what the stance should be. As a society, we are not comfortable with the idea of private schools. We don't have a coherent stance towards private schools. In particular, there is this entrenched view. It's kind of a sanctimonious view, I suppose, in some ways, schools should be free. They should be run by philanthropists and benefactors. And of course, schools, parents do desire good education. That's why private schools are flourishing. But parents also complain about fee because, perhaps understandably, they complain about fee because on the one hand, as taxpayers, they're paying for what government should be providing them, which is free education, which is what the Constitution also promises. But they are not getting that free education of any quality, so they feel compelled to have to pay somewhere else, and they naturally grumble about that. And because of charging fee, they're characterized in all kinds of ways that Vikas has said, profiteering, greedy, grabbing, sort of mushrooming, vilified in many different ways. But then you see policy stance, even new policy stance, is not very clear. On the one hand, it looks very promising. The National Education Policy says that, private schools and public schools will be on the same level playing field. So that sounds like a pretty clear statement. But on the other hand, it says private schools that are publicly spirited will not be stifled. But who will decide which private schools are public spirited and which are not? And it leaves open this ambiguity, which can be exploited by those who want to continue to have that view about, private schools, that these are, these should not really exist. Of course, despite the hostile environment, their numbers have increased. Private schools numbers have increased. And that is like, Gurcharan Das says that India grows by night. So that is because of Jugaad and all sorts of backstreet ways of getting on, even if they're perhaps not fulfilling all the requirements of the Right to Education Act, the norms of recognition of the Right to Education Act. And this duplicity, when they say on the playing level fields, but it's not the case, because government schools are not closed down if they don't fulfill the norms of the RTE Act, but private schools are. And this is hardwired in, into an act. The Right to Education Act hardwires this inequality, this differential treatment right there and there. So I think that post-COVID situation for affordable private schools will depend very much on whether the policies of the new education policy are implemented and implemented well. Let us see that, for example, when it says that Parakh will test children both in private schools and in government schools, hopefully, you know, the support packages that come regarding teacher training, etc., will apply equally to both. Let's hope so, but I'm not so sure.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Kingdon. Now we have roughly only 2 minutes left. And let me quickly get like 30 seconds response from all of you about the future of APS. What do we see, whether APS will survive, die, what will happen? I can see there is a comment in the chat box and someone says APS will die, a slow death. I run 3 schools. I had to shut down one. I also shut down 4 pre-primary schools. I am now starting a digital marketing consultancy. So there are people, and in rural areas also, I've seen schools are being closed. Shut down as well. So how do we see the future? Quick, 30 seconds. I'm sorry, I don't have time left.
Can I, my mic is on, so I can.
Yes, please. Go on.
Just on building on what Professor Kingdon has said, I think the level playing field NEP talks about, but if you look at government expenses, and this part of the research that we did for the report that's going to come out on liberalization of private schools, is the government spends at least 30 to 35,000 per student per annum. And now if we talk about level playing field, that is nowhere near what we're talking about for affordable private schools. We're talking about 12,000 rupees, 15,000 rupees at max. If we really want to talk about level playing field, the way to do it is to rationalize regulations, the RTE norms, I mean, the kind of which schools like Sunshine can also not meet. If they had to, I mean, put everything in down on, you know, paper. So regulations have to be flexible. The not-for-profit mandate has to go away. Professor Kingdon has just talked about it. Doesn't the reality is something that we all know as far as private schools are concerned. It cannot be, it is not-for-profit, and it can't remain if you want good people and good capital to come into the sector. And the third is that the funding of students needs to happen directly rather than funding of schools. And that also means that, and there are governments which are starting to look in this direction. So it is happening in some ways. Governments recognize that eventually, if you want to deliver education, it may not happen only through public education setup. And that mindset where if you speak to most government officials, they speak about hamare bache aur baki bache, or ya unke bache. So hamare bache is the one they are concerned about, which is basically public education. But that okay. The funding and the regulation has to separate. And that's one of the things which NEP also says very clearly. So these are things that need to happen for the affordable private.
Rajendra ji, your 30 seconds, please.
Yes. I want to conclude by saying education is not for free, even if government schools. Government spends around 62,000 crores per year for primary and secondary education. If you cut down 15% of that, or 15% reduction, so we get around 9,300 crores. We can open 845 affordable schools in 1 year, only cutting down the government primary school budget by 15%. Education is not for free. This myth developed in our mind that overcharging, overpricing has to go, and parent and schools have to come together, because they will be at a greater loss if schools close down. And my submission to this panel is to that, finally, that parent and that school has to come together and work together. That's the way ahead.
Perfect. Vikas, your last 30 seconds.
I think short term, I think we see some problems, but I think the particular reason why they exist still remains, purely because I think, and you know, I hope I'm proving wrong, that the political will to really reform government schools is still not there. You know, because ultimately, this requires a huge amount of political will, and education is still not an election issue. And therefore, that will not happen. If that doesn't happen, then the reason for affordable private schools will be there. I think one last thing I'll say is that the sad thing is that we actually have an amazing opportunity like we had 30 years ago with the license Raj being removed with liberalization, where we had the same situation where in manufacturing and services, India opened up the regulation. That's all it did. It opened up the regulations and it basically allowed animal spirits of the market to come in. And we see the result in terms of the growth in the Indian economy and the millions of people who have come out of poverty. We can actually do the same thing in education today. You know, it's as simple as that. You don't have to do a lot. You just have to reduce the barriers to entry that, as Vardhan said, prevent good people from coming in into the sector, the not-for-profit rule, number one, and the input requirements. And you'll actually unleash the animal spirits. And really, you will have an opportunity for children of India to be able to get a much higher quality education. This is not very difficult from a, it's papers that need to be passed. The problem is the political will, you know, and the narrative that Geeta talked about. And if you really believe that education, it doesn't, you know, if you really care about quality of education for the children, as opposed to quality being delivered through a government school or private school, then this makes that this is an opportunity that we could really, you know, benefit from.
Great, great. Thank you very much. We have already exceeded time for by 4 minutes. So let me close this conversation here. I know whenever I start talking to all of you, I continue going, and we can go on, but we have to finish it off. The only thing towards closing of this conversation, I would only say that education requires all stakeholder engagement, parents, teachers, schools, government, everyone will have to come together and work together for the benefit of education. When Vardhan was talking about that, the funding also has to be realigned. Now there is a new thing that has come up called e-Rupee, and I'm very excited about it, that it can change the targeting of welfare delivery, and that has a potential use in education system as well. But let's work together with a positive spirit. I hope the way the education was devastated due to COVID, the future is bright and bright and better. And that is the theme that we are following at Charcha 2021. Let's build back better. And this is where we should close this conversation. Thank you very much to all our panelists. Thank you very much to the organizers. And thank you very much to the admin, which is supporting here. Back to Khushi and Mohit to close this discussion here. Thank you very much. Take care.
Thank you, Amit.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone.